Good morning. Welcome to the 8:30 service. It's really 7:30, but welcome anyway. You're brave to be here. We're continuing our studies in the book of Romans. We're in chapter 16 this morning, and we're going to look at verses 1 through 16, which is a lot of names. Paul writes, "I commend to you our sister Phoebe, who is a servant of the church, which is at Cenchrea, that you receive her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints, and that you help her in whatever matter she may have need of you, for she herself has also been a helper of many and of myself as well. Greet Prisca and Aquila." Prisca is the alternate name of Priscilla. We're more familiar with that. That's the diminutive of Prisca, but we see it often mentioned in this way. "Greet Prisca and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus, who for my life risked their own necks, to whom not only do I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Also greet the church that is in their house. Greet Epaphroditus, my beloved, who is the first convert to Christ from Asia. Greet Mary, who has worked hard for you. Greet Andronicus and Junius, my kinsmen and my fellow prisoners, who are outstanding among the apostles, who also were in Christ before me. Greet Ampliatus, my beloved in the Lord. Greet Urbanus, our fellow worker in Christ, and Stachys, my beloved. Greet Apelles, the approved in Christ. Greet those who are of the household of Aristobulus. Greet Herodian, my kinsman. Greet those of the household of Narcissus who are in the Lord. Greet Tryphena and Tryphosa, workers in the Lord. Greet Persis, the beloved, who has worked hard in the Lord. Greet Rufus, a choice man in the Lord, also his mother and mine. Greet Asyncritus, Philegon, Hermes, Patrobas, Hermas, and the brethren with them. Greet Philologos and Julia, Nereus and his sister, and Olympus, and all the saints who are with them. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the churches of Christ greet you." May the Lord bless this reading of his word and bless our time together in it. Let's pray. We're in the last chapter of the book of Romans, and Paul is concluding his letter, as he often did, with greetings to friends in the church. In 16 verses, he mentions people, most of whom we know nothing about other than their names listed here. So it's a section of the book that would be easy to pass over. That would be a mistake. Chapter 16 is similar to 2 Samuel 23 that records the list of David's mighty men. Men like Adino, chief of the captains, who killed 800 at one time. Eleazar, who fought the Philistines with David and struck them until his hand was weary and clung to the sword. Benaiah, who went down and killed a lion in the middle of a pit on a snowy day, and many others. For their courage and service, their names were recorded in the Bible and have been remembered over the long centuries of history. 2 Samuel 23 is an honor roll, and Romans 16 is like that. Paul's intention was simply to greet his friends, but his greetings have memorialized real people who were faithful to God and loved by the apostle. There are few honors greater than that, going down in history as a companion of the Apostle Paul, being called his beloved, his friend, his fellow worker, and fellow prisoner. But the greetings and honors that Paul gives here say as much about him as they do about those that he honored. They show that he was a man who had strong personal ties. He was not some secluded scholar, but a man who was involved with people and interested in them. And also, Leon Morris noted, it is significant that this letter, which has given us so much solid doctrinal teaching, should end with this emphasis on persons, on love, and on a reminder that humble servants of God perform all sorts of active ministry. They do perform ministry. It is important ministry, which is necessary for the church to function effectively. This passage really gives us a window on the early church. Christians were active members. Paul appreciated his friends and their service and expressed his affection and concern for them in this final chapter of the book, which means that God appreciates it in us and remembers it. First to be mentioned is Phoebe. Paul calls her our sister. She was from Cenchrea, which was the northern port of the city of Corinth. And Paul recommends her to the Romans. In the early church, Christians carried letters of commendation when they traveled from place to place to confirm that they were believers, that they were in good standing in the church, and that they should be received into fellowship. The commendation of Phoebe at the end of the letter indicates that she was probably the person who brought it to Rome, which is a story in itself, a story of providence. The original copy of the book of Romans, the greatest letter ever written, the only copy of it was entrusted to a woman to face the hazards of travel and deliver it safely to Rome. I can just imagine Paul handing Phoebe this precious scroll, which she then stuffed in her purse and sailed off to Rome. It seems risky. And if her purse was anything like my wife's, it's a miracle that it wasn't lost in the purse. Well, Donald Gray Barnhouse gives us a sense of the risk and the responsibility that she took on. He wrote, "Never was there a greater burden carried by such tender hands. The theological history of the church through the centuries was in the manuscript which she brought with her. The Reformation was in that baggage. The blessing of multitudes in our day was carried in those parchments." And that's true. And Paul entrusted all of that to Phoebe. But he knew what he was doing. Phoebe was a very reliable person who had proven she was faithful. Paul commends her to the Romans as a servant of the church, which is at Cenchrea. The Revised Standard Version, for example, translates this, "Phoebe, a deaconess of the church at Cenchrea." Now, that's a possible interpretation of the word in verse 1, a servant. It could be translated as deacon, deaconess, but that is not at all a necessary translation. In verse 2, Paul states that Phoebe ministered to the saints. He calls her a helper of many, which seems sufficient to define Paul's meaning in verse 1. Phoebe was a deacon in a general sense, if not an official sense. She was a servant of the church, but still a very important person. Christians don't have to hold an office in the church to be of active service, to minister to people. It is the responsibility of every one of us to do that. Phoebe served somehow, in some capacity, evidently in many capacities, and in a very significant way. Paul doesn't tell us how, but there were needs in the church that were more appropriately met by women than by men. as in assisting women in baptism or in visiting them in their homes. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 12, Paul puts two limitations on the role of women in the church. They are not to teach men and they are not to exercise authority over them. But there are many opportunities for women to teach. To teach women, to teach children, and today in our Sunday schools. In fact, women are often the best teachers in those areas. There are opportunities for ministry of mercy, and women are often more effective in that as well. There was a group of women that followed Christ and ministered to him and the disciples. Luke mentions them in Luke chapter 8 and verse 2, Mary Magdalene and others. When Paul was in Philippi, Lydia, whose heart had been opened by the Holy Spirit to receive the things that were spoken by Paul, opened her home to him and his friends, showed them hospitality and ministered to them in that way. Probably the church met in her home afterwards, and through the time of Paul's ministry. Phoebe could have had a ministry like that, could have had a ministry in any number of ways. In fact, some feel that she had a ministry much like that of Lydia, who was a wealthy businesswoman. The description of Phoebe in verse 2 as a helper is a word that can mean patroness or benefactress or protectress, which suggests that she was a woman of means and used her wealth in the service of the church and Paul. Whatever she did, Phoebe took many opportunities to serve the saints. She served the apostle and the church throughout the ages by safely delivering Paul's letter to the church at Rome. And so he asks the church to help her with her needs, whatever she might need, to give her a worthy welcome, one that was fitting of Christian kindness and hospitality, just as she had done for others. In the remaining verses 3 through 16, Paul gives greetings to his friends in the church at Rome. He greets 26 individuals, 24 he names, 2 he does not. Apart from Priscilla and Aquila, we know nothing about any of them, but all of them are significant in part because they give a glimpse into the nature and the makeup of the early church. It was diverse in race, gender, and class. Paul calls some his kinsmen, which means his fellow Jews, and a few of the names are Jewish, like Herodian in verse 11. Other names are Latin, most are Greek, but they all represent different nations, different ethnic groups. They differ in social status. John Stott writes that inscriptions indicate that Ampliatus, Urbanus, Hermes, Philologos, and Julia were common names for slaves. Some were freed people, and some of those names had links to people of great distinction at the time. Aristobulus, for example, mentioned in verse 10, was the name of the grandson of Herod the Great, who was a close friend of the Emperor Claudius. And some commentators think that this Aristobulus is he. Also, that Narcissus, mentioned in verse 11, was a well-known freedman who was rich and powerful, and he's also influential in Rome and also a close friend of the emperor. But Paul is not suggesting that these two men became Christians, but there were Christians in their households, family members or slaves, and they were in important households of Rome. So he mentions the households and those in them. We know from the book of Philippians that the gospel penetrated Caesar's household. So the gospel had gone everywhere, from the loftiest places of the city to the lowest places of the city, all within that first generation of the apostles. It's also significant that of the 26 people mentioned, 9 are women, 10 if we count Phoebe. Now that is an impressive number when you consider that they lived in a male-dominated society. What that shows is the elevated status that women had in the church, as well as Paul's attitude toward them. He honored women. He understood that they have different roles in the church. He makes that very clear in the pastoral epistles and in the book of 1 Corinthians as well. But he taught that they were equal persons to men and before God, that they were equal in intelligence and equal in their value in the ministry. He calls Priscilla a fellow worker and Junius a fellow prisoner. He thought so highly of Phoebe that he entrusted the book of Romans to her. But what is especially significant about this list is the emphasis it puts on the universality of the church. God's love is for the world, meaning for all kinds of people, elect from every nation. The Church of Jesus Christ is a diverse company of people, but they are also a united people, and Paul lays great stress on that in this passage. Four times he refers to his friends as being in Christ, and five times he speaks of them as being in the Lord. There are all kinds of people in the world, but all who are saved in one way and in the same way, and that is through the person and work of Jesus Christ. He is the only Savior. And having been saved by Him, we are all joined to Him equally, male and female, slave and free, Oriental and Occidental, united together in Him with a unity that transcends all of the differences that we have. All through this chapter, Paul reminds believers of their unity in the Lord and Paul's unity with them. He rejoiced in it. He called Jews and Gentiles alike his friends and beloved. His greetings to them reveal a lot about Paul and his genuine interest in people. But they also give us some understanding of life in the early church. Some of the names are of special interest. The first people he greets are Prisca and Aquila, or Priscilla and Aquila. They were husband and wife. Aquila was a tent maker from Pontus, which was located on the northern rim of the of Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey, on the Black Sea. He had settled in Rome. He'd married Priscilla, but they were forced to leave the capital when the Emperor Claudius expelled the Jews from the city. They traveled to Corinth, where Paul met them, having just arrived from Athens. Paul also was a tent maker, and so that profession seems to have brought them together, and the three became fast friends. They worked together and ministered together. Paul calls them his fellow workers. When Paul left Corinth and traveled to Ephesus, they went with him. They remained there after Paul moved on and were able to instruct Apollos in the faith, which says a great deal about this couple. Apollos was a Jew from Alexandria, described as being eloquent and mighty in the scriptures. He was evidently a very learned, brilliant man. He preached boldly in the synagogue, but he lacked a full knowledge of Christ. And so, having heard him, Luke tells us in Acts chapter 18 and verse 26, Priscilla and Aquila took him aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. Well, they were biblically and theologically capable people, and they cared. They took an interest in this man. And they instructed him. Both of them did. By the time Paul returned to Corinth, they had resettled in Rome and had a church that was meeting in their house, according to verse 5. Now, they also had one in Ephesus. Paul tells us that when he wrote the 1 Corinthians at the end of that book, chapter 16. He also greets various people, friends, and he mentions the church that they had when they lived at Ephesus. Wherever they went, they had a meeting in their home. Wherever they went, they spread the gospel. They used their time and their possessions in Christ's service. For them, life was not about accumulating things or having experiences. It was about Christ, and they were ready to lay down their lives for him and the saints. Paul refers to an incident when they almost did that for him, who for my life risked their own necks, which literally means something like put their neck under the axe for me. Quite obviously, it means they risked their lives to save his life. He doesn't reveal the incident, doesn't tell us what they did, but there were many, many times when he was in great danger in Corinth and in Ephesus. In fact, in 1 Corinthians 15, he mentions that he fought with wild beasts in Ephesus, which raises all kinds of questions of what he meant. Did he literally do that, or is he speaking of something that happened in a figurative way but was very, very dangerous? And either way, his life was at risk, and his friends were there to help him. These two were ready to put their neck under the axe for the Apostle Paul. They were a remarkable couple that lived for Christ and to serve his people. That is how the gospel was spread in the first century. Christians telling others about salvation in Jesus Christ and serving one another sacrificially. These weren't clergymen, these weren't professional ministers. They were ordinary people being witnesses wherever they went, willing to make sacrifices, willing to suffer much. Paul acknowledges that about some of those he greeted here. In verse 6, he greets Mary, who has worked hard for you. I wonder what Mary did for those Roman Christians. I will bet you she worked in the nursery. I bet you she did whatever she could for them. And that's, working in the nursery is not a small thing. It is a necessary thing. There are lots of things that may seem small, but really go into making a church function smoothly. And it's not something that should be despised. I don't know what Mary did, but I know she did much for the church in Rome. In verse 12, Paul greets Tryphena and Tryphosa, who may have been twin sisters. Their names sound so similar that that may be the case. Their names mean delicate and dainty. And you might think that Paul was a bit amused by that because their names were in such contrast to their lives. He calls them workers. They were delicate, they were dainty, but they got down and worked for the Lord. In the same verse, he greets another woman, Persis, who has worked hard in the Lord, he says. Obviously, from this, it's clear that women made a large contribution to the early church and had a very direct hand in the success of the ministry. These people sacrificed much and, like Paul, suffered much. In verse 7, he greets another couple, Andronicus and Junius. And that word Junius can be Junia. It's not clear whether the name is masculine or feminine, but most or many commentators believe that this is probably a woman. Junia would be a good translation, which means this was probably a married couple. Paul describes them as his kinsmen, meaning that they were a Jewish couple who, he says, were in Christ before me. So they were old believers. They were likely in the church of Jerusalem in its early days. He also calls them fellow prisoners who were outstanding among the apostles. The word apostles has the definite article, so it refers to the 12. The 12 apostles had a high regard for this couple, in part at least because they had suffered for Christ. They were fellow prisoners with Paul. He had shared a jail cell with them. He'd suffered with them. And in that situation became very close friends with them. It's interesting that Paul calls them outstanding, and yet we don't know anything about them other than what is written here, other than he calls them outstanding among the apostles, that the apostles had high regard for them. But that it suggests something. It suggests that there were likely other outstanding Christians in the early church of whom we know nothing, men and women who bravely stood for Christ when it was dangerous to do so. Others are mentioned of whom we know nothing: Urbanus, Stachys, Apelles, and Herodian. They are called beloved, approved, and fellow workers. Those are great testimonies to Christian lives. Maybe the most intriguing name on the list is the one in verse 13, Rufus. It means red. And we find it also in the Gospel of Mark. Mark records that when Christ stumbled under the weight of the cross, Simon of Cyrene was pressed into service and made to carry the cross the rest of the way to Calvary. Mark states that he was the father of Alexander and Rufus. Now that's significant because it's generally agreed that the Gospel of Mark was written to the Romans. Evidently, the point of mentioning Simon's two sons is they were well known in the church at Rome. And here Paul names one of them, Rufus. Paul describes him as a choice man in the Lord. Literally, those words are the elect in the Lord. That may be the meaning, but since all Christians are elect of God, all Christians are chosen unconditionally before the foundation of the world, it probably does not have that meaning here. That wouldn't distinguish Rufus from any other Christian when it seems that that's exactly what Paul was doing. He was singling him out for special praise. So the idea is he is a choice or exceptional believer. Paul also gives a greeting to Rufus's mother, who had on some occasion provided Paul with hospitality and care, evidently in a significant way, because he speaks of her as his mother. That's how close they were. So this was a believing family that was active in ministry, which, if it is the family of Simon, must have an interesting story behind it, one of God's providence and grace. Simon had come to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover when unexpectedly he was chosen at random from the crowd to carry Christ's cross. A Roman soldier simply grabbed this man. He was on his way somewhere. Suddenly he is impressed into service, and there he is carrying the cross of Christ, and his life was changed forever. I don't know what happened when he took hold of that cross, but I can imagine that as he did so, he looked into the face of Jesus as he was on the pavement, and he saw this face that had been beaten and bloodied beyond recognition, but his eyes met with his eyes and it affected him. And then he went to Golgotha, and there he witnessed the crucifixion, and he listened to the Lord's words, heard the testimony of the thief and the centurion, and was brought to faith in Christ as the Son of God and the Savior of the world. After the Passover, he returned to Cyrene in North Africa, told his family about Christ, and they believed through his testimony. It's not hard to imagine that that happened. In fact, it's interesting. From the book of Acts, we read of this delegation that left from Cyprus and Cyrene and went to evangelize the Gentiles. It's not hard to imagine that Simon was among that group, or His sons were among that group, and they went to this great city of Antioch, and they evangelized. In fact, that's the first place that the Gentiles were given the gospel, and these people, these unnamed people from Cyprus and Cyrene, began to speak to them about Jesus Christ, and many were saved. In fact, the greatest church of that era was the church at Antioch. Perhaps these men were among them, and perhaps Rufus was one of those. God works in this way. His grace is just like that, like you can imagine that took place, which I'm certain did, with Simon. It visits us unexpectedly. It did with C.S. Lewis. He has an interesting story to tell, which he told in the book Surprised by Joy. It's his spiritual autobiography, how he was raised and his experiences in the public schools in England and the difficulties that he had and how he was an atheist early in his life, but he changed. And it's not really until the end of the book that he gives that conversion experience that he had, but he describes it as a surprise, as the title puts it. He says he knew very well when he was saved, but hardly how that final step was taken. So he says he left one morning. They were going to the zoo. And he said, we left on a sunny morning, and as we set out, he said he didn't believe that Jesus Christ was the Son of God, and by the time he got to the zoo, he did. He doesn't know what happened, but it did happen. It happened unexpectedly. That's grace. It visits us unexpectedly and in unexpected ways. What is true about it in every experience is God always takes the initiative and seeks those who aren't seeking Him. He snatches us all like brands from the fire. He surprises us with His grace. And the reality is, whether we know it or not, we've all been surprised by His grace. Well, Rufus, Simon's son, maybe, was certainly God's elect, chosen from all eternity and drawn irresistibly to the Savior with God-given faith. That's the grace that every believer in Jesus Christ has received. There are interesting stories behind each name listed here. Someday we will hear them. We'll all hear them. And we'll hear many, many others. Paul ends the passage with instruction to greet one another with a holy kiss. The idea is that a verbal greeting should be confirmed with a visible gesture. And in that day, it was with a kiss. Well, assuming that that gesture will be determined according to culture, J.B. Phillips, in his paraphrase of the New Testament, translated this verse, give one another a hearty handshake all around for my sake. I've been in foreign cultures, foreign lands in different cultures, and I've been places where that they practice the holy kiss. And a little surprising when you're not expecting it to get kissed on both cheeks as a greeting. I do prefer the handshake, I will say that. So I would like to believe that he's got a good idea there. Well, then Paul sends greetings from all the churches, probably referring to those from the churches of Greece and Asia who were preparing to go with Paul to Jerusalem. They're mentioned by Luke in Acts chapter 20 and verse 4. It's an interesting passage, this passage we have been studying here in Romans 16, and that gives good information about the early church, about its situation, about its composition and activity. We get some insight into Paul's personality here, the kind of man that he was. He was a man with many friends, people who are unfriendly, who lack joy, who lack the fruit of the Spirit, don't have lots of friends. He had lots of friends, lots of people whose lives he had invested in. It's a lesson for us in that. But there's passage is full of lessons for us. We're also reminded of what is really important, about what Paul thought was important, what these people obviously thought was important, and that was spiritual labors, spiritual accomplishments, not material comfort. These early Christians sacrificed comfort. They were single-minded in their devotion to Christ. It was their life. They were all in the ministry. Men and women alike, regardless of their backgrounds, they were all in the ministry. They weren't bench warmers. This was an every-member ministry church that Paul addressed. And so they are remembered as a helper of many, fellow workers in Christ, risked their own necks, fellow prisoners, worked hard in the Lord, and so on. In the speech Henry V gave in Shakespeare's play, he tells the army just before the Battle of Agincourt that they would be envied by others. They would be remembered for what they did that day to the end of history. We few, we happy few, we band of brothers. These who served with Paul were his band of brothers and sisters. They did God's work and have been remembered for it. What we do will be remembered to the end of history, if not by men, by God. What is done for him is never forgotten. And someday he will open the books where our names and our deeds are written. He will recall them and reward us. Now that's worth living for, worth working hard for in his service and risking our necks for. But if you have not believed in him, if you have not believed in Jesus Christ, whom these people served and risked their lives for, you cannot serve him. You are not with him. In fact, you are against him. Whether you have a sense of hostility or not, Paul has described in the book of Romans the natural man as being at enmity, at war with God, and that is universally the case. And the result of that is you're under divine judgment. But there is a way of escape. It is faith in God's eternal Son who became a man and died in our place so that everyone who trusts in him will have forgiveness and eternal life. All who come to him, he receives and blesses. So look to Christ, believe in him, and having believed in him, live for him, serve him faithfully. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us and for this list of names and the very short biographies of some of these people. We thank you for their service to you and how it is a model for us. Help us be inspired by these people and to do the same. Regardless of who we are, we have an opportunity to serve you. It's an opportunity here to serve you. Make us willing and give us a desire to do that, and to do that to your honor and glory. And you will bless us for it, we know. We thank you for Christ, for his death for us. Help us to understand better your grace and the gift that you have given us in him and all that he's done for us. And that will certainly move us to serve him faithfully. We pray these things in his name. Amen.